He might come towards you, and then you could get him. You know, over that prison.
In the next 26 minutes, we will present a visual summary of the anesthesian surgery techniques we currently use in black-tailed rattlesnakes, which have been developed during an ongoing 12-year study. During that time, 45 individual rattlesnakes have been followed in the field using radio telemetry, some for up to 9 years. On this day, we found a new male, 2 meters behind our number 20 female, and apparently following. On this day, we found a new male, 2 meters behind our number 20 female, and apparently following her. He is captured using Pilstrom tongs and placed in a Fermont stick bag. These nylon bags have the advantage of being able to see the snake within the bag and keep track of the head, but they also have the downside that the snake can easily bite through the bag. Twisting the bag, the snake is isolated to the bottom, and then using tongs and forceps, it is placed in my pack to be transported back to the Sea Surge lab, where later this morning a radio transmitter will be implanted and he will become our new 44 male. Back at the Sea Surge lab that same morning, the new male is transferred from the bag into a bucket so that we can tube it for general anesthesia and surgery. We feel tubing the rattlesnake is the best technique, less stress to the animal and perhaps safer for us. It sometimes takes a little patience to tube a snake because they don't always want to go right up in the tube. But eventually, with the head and neck in the tube, one can reach in then and grab the rattlesnake at its body and the tube at the same point. And then the snake is safely immobilized.
We have this tube made into a chamber with a rubber sheet down across the top here, some gauze, and back here a cotton just to block this off and to kind of seal it up, make it into a chamber. I'm going to inject sevoflurane, 1 milliliter liquid, and it will volatilize in that gauze. That's the anesthetic seal for a, and we'll time it, taking about 10 minutes to go off to sleep, breathing this inhalation anesthetic.
Sevoflurane is a new anesthetic agent and better than isoflurane, which is the current anesthetic available to biologists. The snake will be asleep in about 12 to 15 minutes.
Okay, so after breathing a little sevoflurane here, the snake begins to feel a little funny. Sometimes they'll evacuate their cloaca, and so I've got a paper towel there. Okay, here's the heartbeat. You see it's clicking along probably between 70 and 80 beats per minute. The snake is nice and warm. I'm going to mark that. We can refer to that later in case there's circulatory depression. Okay, we're going to verify the sex of this snake. We're sure it's a male, mainly because of the length of the tail. In fact, it was pursuing a female, but we just verify that with probing, and we can put this probe right up the invagination of the inverted hemlock peony on the right side here, and it goes in that far. And in fact, with this blunt probe, it can go in on both sides. Not necessary to do that, but there again, it goes in about that far. So two hemipenes, this is a male. Okay, well, I'm using provodone iodine, or betadine, and we'll prep the skin with that prior to surgery. So our incision is going to be in this area of the body. I'm using this sterile sponge. I've washed my hands. This is a clean procedure, not a sterile procedure. So I've opened some sterile gloves. The gloves are sterile, and so is the inside of the wrapping, so we'll use the covers here, which are sterile, to lay our instruments and suture. Okay, we've been soaking the transmitter and some instruments. And the Zephyrin solution for about an hour. And now I'm going to just rinse all this off with a little sterile water. Again, this isn't sterile, it's clean. We'll try and keep it as clean as possible. And I'll lay all this down over here, transmitter. And now I can put on the other glove. And I can do that without contaminating it. And I'm using glue so I can see a little better. Go ahead and open the suture, which is a monofilament suture. It's a little bit springy, so let's give it a little stretch here. Now, using a needle hole, we're going to attempt to tie an anchor suture here around this transmitter in such a way that we can suture it into the muscles of the body and keep it from migrating backward in the body. There's a little notch here. And this will anchor, then I can sew it into the muscle, and this will anchor the transmitter from migrating posteriorly in the snake. Now I'm going to make a lateral incision here, two scale rows up from the belly scutes. And I'm going to use scissors to do that. About a centimeter and a half long. Just long enough to get the transmitter in place. Now I'm going to reflect the ribs back and go down in here into the salamic or peritoneal cavity, go through the peritoneum. And I see fat bodies, which I see right now. And I'm going to put the transfer in right there. I don't know if you can see that. And now I'm going to sew it through the muscle and suture it so it will be anchored there. I'm going to pick up this needle driver and needle holder. Go right into the muscle here. Okay, to get the antenna subcutaneously, we take this small brass tube that we soaked in Zephyrin, and we go subcutaneously outside the ribs and up under the skin, right up forward, and then here goes the flexible antenna. Up inside the tube, then I'll pull the tube out and it will leave the antenna subcutaneous. I'll do that in just a moment. First, I've got to negotiate getting the curl of this antenna up in the brass tube. There we go. Now, little betadine right here. Okay, we're going to close the incision, and so starting above, simple suture through, and then from ventral to the top side, another simple suture going about 3 millimeters below and back about 3 millimeters. Side. Now when we tie this up snugly, it'll evert the dermal layers and make them heal quickly. I'm trying to economize on my suture here. So we've got two sutures in, now we move down 3 millimeters, down, maybe 4, and 3 millimeters back, and the same distance down below here. Through, and then when we tie up snugly, it's going to evert the dermal layers. and get a good tight closure and for quick healing. If you use a simple suture, just through and through, it'll allow the skin edges to roll under and you don't get good apposition and healing. At least it's possible you wouldn't get good healing. So, vent length. A 1,065. 82 millimeters from the vent to the base of the basal segment, not including the basal segment. Okay, we're going to put the scale back to zero and lay number 43 male to be in here. He's tongue flicking, so he's waking up, that's good. And he weighs 903 grams. Okay, waking up, these snakes aren't dangerous, they're out of it, they're not thinking about defensive strikes. However, we keep them tubed. This one's already tongue flicking, he's waking up, so we have to do the rest of this processing while he awakens. I'm going to inject fluids here, about 38 cc's. So we're injecting normal saline, 4% of the body weight for sure. This animal is more or less 38 milliliters of normal, sterile normal saline.
As part of a concurrent hormone study in our snakes, we take blood samples while the snake is awakening from anesthesia. We use the method of cardiac puncture because when the snake's relaxed under general anesthesia, the heart is rather easily palpated. Once its position is found, the heart's stabilized, and using a 25-gauge needle, we enter the ventricle and the blood sample is withdrawn. General anesthesia allows us to use this technique rather than tail vein venipuncture, which is more easily done when the snakes are awake.
Okay, we drew this blood. In this case, we had to go to the heart to draw the blood. Now I'm putting it into a small centrifuge tube.
When the operation is near completion, the end of the tube is uncovered and the snake allowed to breathe room air and awaken.
This is the PIT tag, passive integrated transponder. It's going to go intraperitoneally.
To make this video, we use two individual male rattlesnakes. Here I'm checking the PIT tag has just been inserted to verify its number. While 28 male is awakening, his frequency is dialed in and the function transmitter we checked.
While the snake is waking up, I'll just demonstrate a little bit of anatomy. Here's the nostril, the eye, and here's the pit, one on each side. And in this relaxed condition, we can just open the mouth gently. Here are the fangs, covered with sheaths. Here's a fang that's being shed, as you can see it. It's loose here in the sheath. The other fang is right there, and there's the shed fang right here. Grab this fang. Can you see it? And there it is. Oops, I dropped it. So there's the shed fang, and it's missing the pedestal, which is dissolved, reabsorbed, and then the fang is lost. And here's the fang that's replaced it. It's right here. Right there. So. Okay, this snake is a little bit depressed with the general anesthetic, and so I'm going to ventilate him artificially using a large intravenous catheter, a barrel of a syringe for an extension, so I don't put my mouth right up here next to his head, and I really can't do it without putting my hand in the way. I'm waiting for his trachea to open, and then I'll insert the in the trachea. Just open, I just inserted it, and I'm going to drop the head down. And now I'm going to use exhaled air and artificial ventilation. The thing about inhalation anesthesia is if the snake is too deep or needs to awaken, one can remove anesthetic agent through the lung using artificial ventilation. Then the snake eventually will breathe on their own and wake up. Okay, that's three breaths. I'm going to remove the endotracheal tube.
After artificial ventilation of 2 to 3 breaths every 4 to 5 minutes, our number 28 male continues to recover from his anesthetic. Once the snake is tongue flicking and crawling, it's ready to be placed in the bucket for its complete recovery. During that time, it's maintained in a warm environment of 80 to 88 degrees Fahrenheit. One of the advantages of inhalation anesthesia over, let's say, injectable ketamine is that this animal will get rid of its anesthetic, and before recovered in the next hour, it can be released even that afternoon of surgery or held overnight and released the next morning. On the following morning, 28 male is returned to his capture site within a wood rat house. It's of interest that our female 21 was also on that morning found just 5 meters away in his vicinity. Now her signal emanates from that same wood rat house. As he crawls in, he stops, apparently encountering her.